Mythology, Egyptian Myths, Goddesses, Gods, and Stories. Written by Coby Evans. Narrated by K.M. Logan. Chapter 1. Mummification Process. The practice of mummifying the dead began in ancient Egypt, 3500 BCE. The English word mummy comes from the Latin mummia, which is originated from the Persian mum, meaning wax, and refers to an embalmed corpse, which was wax-like. The idea of mummifying the dead might have been suggested by how well dead bodies were preserved in dry sands of the nation. Early graves of the Badarian period, 5000 BCE, consisted of food offerings and some serious goods, suggesting a belief in an afterlife. But the dead bodies were not mummified. These graves were shallow rectangles or ovals into which a lifeless body was put on its left side, often in a fetal position. They were considered the last resting place for the deceased and were often, as in Mesopotamia, located in or nearby a family's home. Tombs developed throughout the following periods till, by the time of the early dynastic duration in Egypt, 3150 to 2613 BCE, the mastaba burial place had replaced the easy grave, and cemeteries became typical. Mastabas were seen not as a last resting spot, but as an everlasting home for the body. The burial place was now thought about as a place of change, in which the soul would leave the body to go on to the afterlife. It was thought, though, that the body had to remain intact in order for the soul to continue its journey. Once freed from the body, the soul would really need to orient itself by what recognized for this reason. Burial places were painted with stories and spells from the Book of the Dead to remind the soul of what was happening and what to expect, along with inscriptions known as the pyramid texts and coffin texts, which would recount events from the dead person's life. Death was not the end of life to Egyptians, but simply a shift from one state to another. To this end, the body needed to be thoroughly prepared to be recognizable to the soul upon its awakening in the burial place and also later. The Osiris myth and mummification. By the time of the Old Kingdom of Egypt, 2613 to 2181 BCE, mummification had become standard practice in handling the deceased, and mortuary rituals grew up around death, dying, and mummification. These routines and their signs were mostly stemmed from the cult of Osiris, who had already become a well-known god. Osiris and his sister wife, Isis, were the mythical very first rulers of Egypt, given the land soon after creation of the world. They ruled over a kingdom of peace and harmony, teaching the people the arts of farming, society, and giving males and females equivalent rights to live together in balance and consistency. Osiris's brother Set grew envious of his brother's power and success, however, and so murdered him, first by sealing him in a coffin and sending him down the Nile River, and after by hacking his body into pieces and spreading them across Egypt. Isis recovered Osiris's parts, reassembled him, and after that, with the assistance of her sister Nefertiti, brought him back to life. Osiris was insufficient, though he was missing his penis, which had been consumed by a fish, and so could no longer rule on Earth. He came down to the underworld, where he became the Lord of the Dead. Prior to his departure, though, Isis has mated with him in a form of a kite and bore him a boy, Horus, who would grow up to avenge his dad, reclaim the kingdom, and establish order and balance in the land. This myth became so extremely popular that it instilled the culture and assimilated earlier gods and myths to produce a central belief in a life after death and the possibility of resurrection of the dead. Osiris was typically portrayed as a mummified ruler and frequently represented with green or black skin, symbolizing both death and resurrection. Egyptologist Margaret Bunsen writes, "The cult of Osiris started to use impact on the mortuary rituals and the ideals of contemplating death as an entrance into eternity, this divine being having actually assumed the cultic powers and rituals of other gods of the necropolis or cemetery sites, offered human beings salvation, resurrection, and eternal happiness. Eternal life was only possible, however, if one's body stayed undamaged. An individual's name, their identity, represented their immortal soul, and this identity was connected to one's physical form. Head of the mummy from Ptolemaic Roman Egypt, parts of the soul. The soul was believed to include 9 separate parts. The Khat was the physical body. The Ka was one's double form, the astral self. The Ba was a human-headed bird element, which could speed between earth and the heavens, particularly between the afterlife and one's body. The Shuyet was the shadow self. The Ak was the immortal changed self after death. The Sahu was an aspect of the Ak. The Sekhem was another aspect of the Ak. The Ab was the heart, the source of good and wicked, holder of one's character. The Ren was one's secret name. The Khat needed to exist in order for the Ka and Ba to recognize itself and have the ability to work appropriately. Once released from the body, these different aspects would be confused and would at first need to center themselves by some familiar form. The embalmers and their providers. When a person died, they were brought to the embalmers, who offered 3 types of service. According to Herodotus, the best and most pricey kind is said to represent Osiris. The next finest is rather inferior and cheaper, while the third is most affordable of all. Nardo 110. The mourning family was asked to choose which service they chose, and their answer was exceptionally essential, not only for the departed, but for themselves. Undoubtedly, the best service was going to be the most pricey, but if the family could manage it and yet choose not to purchase it, they ran the risk of a haunting. The dead person would know they had been given a less expensive service than they deserved and would not be able to peacefully go on into the afterlife instead. They would go back and make their relatives' lives miserable till the wrong was righted. Burial practice and mortuary routines in ancient Egypt were taken so seriously just because of the belief that death was not the end of life. The person who had passed away could still see and hear, and if wronged, would be given leave by the gods for vengeance. The mummification process. It would appear, however, that people still chose the level of service they could most quickly pay for. Once chosen, that level determined the kind of casket one would be buried in, the funerary rites readily available, and the treatment of the body. Egyptologist Samila Ikram, professor of Egyptology at the American University at Cairo, has studied mummification in depth and provides the following. The key active ingredient in the mummification was natron, or netri, divine salt. It is a mixture of sodium bicarbonate, salt carbonate, sodium sulfate, and salt chloride that occurs naturally in Egypt. A lot of typically in the Wadi Natron, some 64 kilometers northwest of Cairo. It has desiccating and defatting properties and was the favorite desiccant, though typical salt was also used in more economical burials. In the priciest kind of burial service, the body was set out on a table and washed. The embalmers would then begin their work at the head. The brain was eliminated by means of the nostrils with an iron hook, and what cannot be reached with the hook is rinsed with drugs. Next, the flank is opened with a flint knife, and the entire contents of the abdomen eliminated. The cavity is then thoroughly cleaned and washed out, first of all with palm white wine, and again with an infusion of ground spices. After that, it is filled with pure myrrh, cassia, and every other fragrant substance, excepting frankincense, and sewn up again, after which the body is placed in natron, covered totally over for 70 days, never longer. When this duration is over, the body is washed and then covered from head to foot in linen, cut into strips, and smeared on the underside.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.